Good morning. Welcome to our service of worship at Central Presbyterian Church. No matter who you are or where you are in your journey of faith, you are welcome here as we praise God together. May you be blessed by this service and feeling God's presence. As you can see, I am not Roger Sibert. And as you can see, Stu Fryer is not Liz Sibert. We will be your worship leaders today, as Roger and Liz are a little bit under the weather, and so they are. We hope that they'll get feeling better and be back with us next week. We also wish that Reverend Jules has a wonderful vacation, enjoying her family time. Announcements. The Habitat for Humanity work began on Friday with the construction of the deck. Their next work date is Tuesday, July 12th, and 8:15 to 2:30, and they are still looking for volunteers for our dates going forward. The garage sale is August 11th through the 13th. We are still accepting donations, but no clothing at this point in time. Okay. We are collecting school supplies for the Salvation Army Back to School program, and donations are accepted through July the 17th. Hope Rebecca will be meeting this Wednesday, July 13th at 11 a.m. Are there any other announcements? God is here. Thank you.
Good morning. Please stand and join me in the call to worship. Love the Lord your God. Love your neighbor as yourself, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind. Do this and you will live. Let us worship God. Be seated. Please join me in the prayer confession. God of mercy, we confess that we have failed to live as our beloved sons and daughters. We have set our minds on the things of this world, and we have neglected the inheritance of love and bestow on your saints. We have pursued selfless aims in our daily business. We have harbored uncharitable thoughts towards our enemies and friends. We have avoided difficult responsibilities to our neighbors. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from our selfish ways and strengthen us to be faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ is merciful to all who turn to him in repentance. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. Good morning. When anyone ever asks me to do something, I kind of always want to know what is required of that job, okay? If you're a young person and taking a class, you want to know what's required in this class for me to pass, okay? For your driver's license, what is required of you in order to get your license? Many of you know John and I just bought a scooter. We want to know what's required of us to get that added little thing on our license that allows us to drive that scooter on the streets. Okay, if you're a pet sitter, you want to know what's required of you in this job. Well, today I've got a challenge for you, and it's the Micah 6:8 challenge. We always want to know, what does God want from us? Well, we find in Micah 6:8, it actually lays it right out. What does the Lord require of you? But to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. I was reading my Bible this week and I came across that verse and I thought, wow, you know, it's really laid out for us right there. And I thought, well, what does that really mean? Do justice. Well, I found some things on the internet, some ideas. List people who are not treated fairly and ask God how you or your family might help. Write down any ideas that come to mind. Find clothes in your house and donate them. Leave an encouraging chalk message about doing justice on your sidewalk. Okay? Love mercy. Pray when an ambulance or a fire truck passes you by. Okay? Put together bags of supplies to keep in your car to give to homeless people in the street. I know we go on vacation, and oftentimes when we're on vacation, I think, oh, I should have done that. Write a letter or FaceTime or call an elderly relative. That's loving mercy. Walking humbly with God, lead your family in prayer before a meal. Find three things that God has made, thank him, and show them to your parent or to your loved one. Choose a sentence from the Lord's Prayer and pray about it. I thought those are very applicable things that we could do. So, what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. I think I'm going to put that on my mirror this week and kind of try to keep that in the back of my mind as I'm going about my daily activities. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, please keep us attuned to what you require of us, and to help us to do these things this week. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Thanks.
will sing his praises while I live all of my days. Blessed is the man who loves the Lord. Blessed is the man who praises him.
We have some prayer concerns this morning. The Daniel Hugh family, his wife Beth, which is cousin to Lois Werner. She was 38, and her two-year-old son, Paul, they were on bicycles and were hit by a car from behind, and they died at the scene. But their Daniel and their eight-month-old daughter, Faith, are now hospitalized with those injuries. We have a prayer concern from Tom Benko, a co-worker, a wife of his co-worker, Kim Oakes, who has been is to have surgery for a brain tumor. Jerry Sterrett, the son of Jan Sterrett, for health concerns. Lucas Walrath, Gail Billman's nephew, who has CHF. Jeff Walrath, which is Bill's son, has Parkinson's disease. For Ron and Barb Cornell for health issues, and Ron has been in the hospital. And Sue Wesley's mother, Mary Shook, who is 102, fell at her apartment on Friday and fractured her hip, and so she'll be undergoing surgery sometime when they can get her stabled health-wise. Are there any other prayer concerns from the saints? Any other prayers, concerns, joys? Sorry.
Sam's 96-year-old aunt Don fell and not doing too well. She's had a very good
if we can lift those people up in our prayers. Our pastoral prayer this morning is a responsive prayer. If you would respond by saying, "Hear our prayer," every time that I do say, "God of compassion." Let us go to prayer. Gracious God, you know our wounds, our troubles, and our needs, even before we know them ourselves. As the Samaritan showed compassion to the wounded man, you offer mercy to us. We pray for those who are sick or in trouble, Roger and Liz, Cheryl Lash, Jean Kidd, Bill and Charlotte Paulus, Daniel and Faith, Jeff, Jerry, Lucas, Ron and Barb Cornell, Kim Oaks, Donna, Louise, and all those who are on our hearts this day. God of compassion, we pray for all those who suffer the violence of human hands or the tragedy of natural disaster. Shield them with your holy angels and motivate your church to care for them. God of compassion. We pray for children and for the defenseless. Safeguard them in your protection and strengthen your church to tend to them. God of compassion. We pray for the elected officials and for civic leaders. Stir them to heed justice and rouse the church to hold them accountable. God of compassion. We pray for pastors, teachers, musicians, and all the saints who lead your church. Inspire them by your Holy Spirit and guide the church to encourage them. God of compassion. God of compassion, receive our prayers and lead us to all serve in love through Jesus our Lord, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the book of Luke, chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. Most of the time when Roger comes up here when he would work as a liturgist, he would always say, and I know you'll be familiar with these verses, and about maybe 60% of the time I was, but this time I can say this is one I'm familiar with. The parable of the Good Samaritan. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him and saw him. He was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will pay you, repay you, whatever you spend.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The words of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Today's morning sermon is Out of Plumb by Roger Sibert. Let us pray. O God, as we receive your word through your Holy Spirit, open our eyes to your justice, open our ears to your judgment, open our hearts to your love. Amen. Our Old Testament reading today is from the book Amos, which is one of what are commonly referred to as the minor prophets. I suspect they are dubbed minor due to their shorter length. In comparison to other prophetic books of Isaiah, Ezekiel, and Jeremiah, but using the term minor may give us the mistaken impression that the message that Amos delivers is somehow less important. Nothing could be further from the truth. Anyone given a message directly from God with specific delivery instructions, especially to those in authority, can never be considered minor. Amos was given a message directly from Almighty God and was then tasked to delivering that difficult message of justice and truth to God's people. And not just to the people in general, but to those at the top levels of power and authority in the political and religious classes. That, my friends, is a major task. And I believe there's also a major message in this text for us gathered here today. Before digging in, let's set the stage. Amos is not a prophet by trade. He was a shepherd, and a dresser of sycamore trees. And he lived in a small village of Tekoa, which was located about 6 miles south of Bethlehem, which is in the southern kingdom of Judea. He was called to deliver his prophecy to the leadership of the northern kingdom of Israel during the reign of King Jeroboam II, who was on the throne of Israel from about 785 to 745 BC. Jeroboam's lengthy reign of 41 years over the northern tribes receives relatively little attention in the book of 2 James chapter 14, only 6 verses. But Jeroboam led Israel to unprecedented prosperity. The Assyrians had weakened Syria so that it could not cause trouble for Israel. The Assyrians themselves were preoccupied with fighting Armenia. Consequently, Jeroboam was free to carry out an aggressive expansion of his territories. The prophet Jonah had predicted that Jeroboam would restore the boundaries of Solomon's day, and the king reached that goal, as recorded in 2 Kings 14:25. And in 2 Kings 14:27, tells us that the Lord used Jeroboam to save Israel from years of hardship and trouble. Nevertheless, the very prosperity of Jeroboam's kingdom led to many evils, evils which Amos calls out in earlier chapters: greed and oppression of the poor, empty ritualized worship and hypocrisy, and the complacent, self-indulgent lifestyle of upper classes. These and other evils lead us to our passage today from chapter 7, where Amos marches directly into the halls of the religious power and predicts the downfall of Israel. Here is how the words of God from Amos, chapter 7, verses 7 through 17. This is what he showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord says, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will spare them no longer. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste, and I will rise again against the house of Jeroboam with a sword. Then Amazad, the priest of Bethel, sent to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amazad said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away to the lands of Judah, earn your bread there, and prophesy there. But never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary, and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go, prophesy to my people Israel. Now therefore hear the word of the Lord. You say, do not prophesy against Israel, and do not preach against the house of Isaac. Therefore, thus says the Lord, your wife shall become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and daughters shall fall by the sword, and your land shall be parched out by the line. You yourself shall die in an unclean land, and Israel shall surely go into exile away from its land. The priest Amasa was serving at Bethel, which is the central location of worship and should be considered somewhat like the national cathedral. Amazad was ingratified himself with the royal court and is what we might call a political insider. He has the ear of the king, and with it we assume all the trappings of political leadership class. Into this seat of power, Amos, shepherd and dresser of sycamore trees, is sent to deliver a message from Almighty God. Just picture it. Amazad in his ornate priestly robes. Amos, dressed as a commoner, possibly carrying the dirt and the smell of the road. And the message that Amos delivers is not well received. Amos announces that God has set a plumb line in the midst of my people, Israel. God set a plumb line. What is a plumb line? A plumb line is a simple device, simply a string with a weight attached to one end. It is a simple yet critical tool that builders use to ensure a structure, let's say a wall, is straight. The force of gravity assures the plumb line hangs perfectly perpendicular, and holding the plumb line against a structure will quickly verify whether the structure is straight or in plumb, or whether it's not straight, out of plumb. What is the remedy for a wall that is out of plumb? It must be torn down and the construction must be started over. As we previously stated, from the national viewpoint, everything is going well. The leadership has been blinded by prosperity. But this prophecy of Amos is telling the nation of Israel that God has measured them and found them lacking. They're out of plumb. The only remedy was destruction. And sadly, in 722 BC, the prophecy of Amos was fulfilled when Samaria fell to the Assyrians and the northern kingdom of Israel was taken into exile. So what message might we derive from this prophecy of Amos? Well, to begin with, we must point out that our church is doing great work among the poor and needy in our community. This congregation continues to step up with generous donations of money and groceries and household items. Many of you have been blessed by your involvement with these ministries and the personal interaction with our neighbors that has resulted. Our ministries are reaching people with much needed physical and spiritual assistance. But even with all of that, I have to admit, I see the uncomfortable similarities in my position to that of Amazad the priest. I live in the most affluent country on earth. I personally live in a very comfortable lifestyle, and I'm an elder in what is considered a mainline church. Is my heart truly reflecting the heart of God to the less fortunate around me? Do I look at those in difficult situations and secretly judge them because, for the most part, it was their own choices that have led them to those results? Do I put myself on a higher plane and feel superior or somehow closer to God because of my own self-perceived righteous position? Am I being blinded by my own prosperity? Returning to Amos and Amazad, we may consider the message and the resulting judgment to be overly harsh. Was destruction really necessary? And in trying to relate all of this to our situation today, on this side of the cross, we may be tempted to say, may what we have been how God operated in the Old Testament, but our New Testament God of grace is surely not in the business of meting out justice in that fashion, right? Well, first of all, we must agree that the exploitation of the poor and needy is surely an offense to God. The Bible makes it very clear, both in Old and New Testaments, that God is concerned with the poor and marginalized. Let's look at our gospel lesson, the story of the Good Samaritan. Interestingly, I see some parallels to what we read in Amos. In the Good Samaritan story, we have a lawyer who is seeking to justify himself. He was concerned with his own position. In Amos, we have Amazad the priest, who is seeking his own justification through political and religious power. In the Good Samaritan story, who do we see passing by the man who is beaten? A priest and a Levite, religious leaders, just like Amasad. And in both stories, we have ones in need of being ignored and taken advantage of by those in positions of privilege, and the plumb line of God calling them to account. You see, God's demand for justice does not disappear with the cross and grace. God's justice is a part of God's grace. It is intertwined with it. It was only through God's gracious act of judgment and exile, the death of the nation of Israel, only through that act could Israel be saved. Thankfully for us, Jesus went to the cross and faced the ultimate exile and death on our behalf. That opened the pathway for us. But we are still called to act. God has a plan for us to be like him. God has a plan to get us back in Plumb. How is this achieved? Our Savior says, enter through the gate, narrow gate, and those who want to save their lives will lose their life. Death to itself is the path to abundant life, the only path. And as long as we are living in this fallen world, we must choose this narrow path of discipleship to Jesus every day, and maybe multiple times a day. It is not possible to retain a self-absorbed life and at the same time expect your heart to reflect God's heart. Now, I realize this may not seem very appealing offer. After all, no one wants to willingly die. But friends, hear this truth. This is good news. The life we are talking about is abundant life, the Jesus life. There is no doubt that Jesus Christ was the most joyful human that has ever walked this earth. In John 15, Jesus said this to his disciples, I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. The joyful Jesus life is ours to be had. I'll finish with some words from C.S. Lewis' book, Mere Christianity, that helps us to grasp this concept. The more we get what we now call ourselves out of the way and let him take us over, the more truly ourselves we become. There is so much of him that millions and millions of little Christs are all different, will still be too few to express him fully. We made them all. He invented, as an author invents characters in a novel, all the different men and women that you and I were intended to be. In that sense, our real selves are all waiting for us in him. It is when I turn to Christ, when I give myself up to his personality, that I begin to have a real personality of my own. Every day when you wake up, your new life awaits. Choose the Jesus life. Amen.
Let us bring to God the fruit of our labors.
Thank you.
Receive these gifts, O God. May our lives be an offering that is pleasing to you. Good gifts that come from the knowledge of life in Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen.
May the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the comfort of the Holy Spirit be with you today and always. Amen.